Well, a very warm welcome to St. John's online service on this Trinity Sunday. We're really glad that you have joined us as we come together to worship our loving Lord God. It has, however, been a hard week. Each of us have been confronted on our screens with images of violence, murder, deep racism in our world. And we have needed and we have wanted to assert that Black Lives Matter. And in the UK too, there's been a report out that shows that the virus has disproportionately affected those from our Black, Asian and minority ethnic communities. There is so much that our hearts grieve for at this time. And yet today, thankfully, is Trinity Sunday. A Sunday when we are reminded of God's generous, deep, wonderful, including love, that he is three in one, a relational, loving God. He's a God who doesn't overlook sin, he doesn't overlook the need for judgment, but he does that perfectly in love, true love, which absorbs within himself, in the Lord Jesus, the hatred of our world, love that brings a better way, and the knowledge for each of us that God is sovereign. And so as we begin our time of worship, we want to come before our loving Lord God and ask for his forgiveness, for those hard parts of our hearts, for our prejudice, for our silence in the face of injustice. And if you want to join in, the words for our prayer will be on the screen. Let's pray. Father, you come to meet us when we return to you. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Jesus, you died on the cross for our sins, which we confess to you now. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Spirit, you give us new life and peace again. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit, all our days. Amen. Well, we're going to praise our loving, forgiving God, three in one, in the words of our next hymn, our first hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God Almighty. Let's praise him together.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, 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 Holy, Lord God Our Old Testament reading is Isaiah chapter 40, verses 12 to 17 and 27 to 31. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, or with the breadth of his hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in a basket, or weighed the mountains on the scales and the hills in a balance? Who has answered the mind of the Lord, who instructed him as his counsellor? Whom did the Lord consult to enlighten him, and who taught him the right way? Who was it that taught him knowledge and showed him the path of understanding? Surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales. He weighs the islands as though they were fine dust. Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Before him all the nations are as nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and complain, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord. My cause is disregarded by God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary. Young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will not run and grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Here ends the reading.
The gospel reading for today comes from Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go to. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make the disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age."
Well, thank you, Tony and Jake, for bringing our Bible readings to us. Let's pray now before we reflect on them and think more about the Trinity together. Father God, we thank you for your word that speaks into our lives. And we ask now that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would illuminate our thinking, that you would challenge us, encourage us as you see fit. And we ask this in and through our Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, this last week has seen on our screens so many distressing images. The horrific murder before our eyes of George Floyd and the deep distress of his family and the anger and the pain of the community in response to that. The violence of the US police and then President Trump's photo shoot outside the church holding a Bible, only moments after he'd ordered the tear gassing of those protesting. What do we do with such injustice? What do we do when we see images of such brutality? What prejudices and blindness does it reveal in our own hearts as well? And yet, this week has also seen wonderful images of love, of reunions. There was a beautiful video of a mum who had been away from her two girls for 9 weeks because she'd been working on an NHS coronavirus ward, and she comes and surprises them, and you hear their cry, "Mummy," as they have tears and embrace her. Really beautiful. Today is Trinity Sunday, when we remember that our God is a God both of justice and of generous, self-giving love, and he longs to draw us into his embrace as our his precious children. And our God is not a lonely, needy God, far from it. He's not a God that needs our love, because he is three in one. And this is the importance of the doctrine of the Trinity. He is God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he's been God as three in one since the beginning of time. God, a God who is about relationship, about joy, and about a love which overflows, which shares and includes. And many stay away from the doctrine of the Trinity, declaring it is something that is too baffling for our finite minds, too irrelevant for our everyday lives. But when we do that, we shortchange ourselves, we shortchange our children too, because we make God smaller, we make him more distant, and we miss out on the joy of knowing who he is, more of who he is, how he is profoundly different to who we think he is, or how we've convinced ourselves he's like. Now, in trying to grasp the Trinity, many have reflected on different illustrations. What about an egg, many might say, you know, with a shell, a yolk and the white, three parts but one egg. How does that work, maybe? Well, it falls apart because they're not distinct or separate from one another. It doesn't really work. Well, some have said, what about the three states of H2O? Water, ice, and steam. Does perhaps that works? And yet they can never be together as one. That doesn't really work. People have also focused on what God is not. The Father is not the Son. The Son is not the Father. The Spirit is not the Father. There are not three gods. But when we speak like that, how does that help us in worship? But at the same time, nor is it helpful, as it's tempting to do, is to shrug and say, well, it's a mystery. We will never understand. Because God wants us to know him. He's revealed himself in Jesus Christ. Michael Reeves says in his helpful book, The Good God, he says this: the Trinity is a God we can know and forever grow to know better. So we start with Jesus, the eternal Son of the Father. Here is God in loving relationship before the beginning of time. God, by his nature, is always loving, as a Father, as a Son, personal. And yet, not just two, not inward looking. The Spirit is the third, the agent of love between the two. The Spirit is the one through whom the Father loves, blesses, and empowers his Son. He is the agent of creation, hovering over the waters, as we read in Genesis 1. The Spirit creates, renews, breathes life into the dead. He rose Christ from the dead. God is, by his very nature, generous and outward looking, drawing others in. And we are drawn in too by the Spirit through Christ's sacrifice on the cross, making us incredibly the fourth in the three, no longer outsiders, no longer distant, but in Christ, partakers of the divine nature. We read that in 2 Peter 1, verse 4. So what does all this mean for our hurting world, for a man, for a world that stops a man breathing, for a world that beats the defenseless, for a world that judges and condemns someone just based on the colour of their skin? Well, it means that we must be different. We must be a people of love who, like our God, are generous and outward looking and life giving and work and fight for justice in our world. Jesus' great commission in our Matthew reading sends us out to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Our faith is not just for a few. It is not for a clique. It is not about judgment. Rather, it is about self-giving, self-emptying love. Love that turns the other cheek, that forgives the other, that goes the extra mile, that puts others' needs first, that embraces, though currently in a very careful, socially distant way. Why do we do this? Because we are loved, we are children of the King, and our actions reflect Him, who He is. The words we use, even our silence. And surely I'm with you to the very end of the age. That's what we read in Matthew 28. The Spirit, as we remembered at Pentecost, is our helper, our counsellor. He reminds us who we are in Christ and how we should live. We are not left alone in this world, neither in our prayers nor in our witness. So today, Trinity Sunday, the Trinity does matter. Who God is matters. How we talk about Him matters. Not because this is something into some intellectual nicety, but because our world needs a God who is love, who is Father, Son, and Spirit, personal, generous, outward looking, knowable, just, and forgiving. This week, may each of us ask the Spirit to show us where we are hard and cold, where and how we don't radiate the love of the Triune God. And rather than sink into despair, to receive the Father's love, to return to Him, to seek the Son's forgiveness and the Holy Spirit's filling, so that each of us, that we can make a difference in this world for His praise and glory. Amen. Well, we're going to respond now in worship as we sing our next song, This Is Amazing Grace. And as we sing it, let's sing it as a prayer, knowing who we are, each of us precious, loved by God because of what Christ has done for each of us. John White is going to lead us as we sing.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mine. shines like the sun. All of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you
Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, you are worthy of glory, honour and praise. Thank you that we can overcome every storm with you, even the impact of this pandemic. We ask today for healing for the sick, comfort for the bereaved, and protection as the lockdown eases. Please calm our anxieties and give us hope as we trust in you. All authority belongs to you, and you have given authority to our leaders in government. We ask that you will impart wisdom and discernment so they will be enabled to continue to guide us through these days of uncertainty. Grant insight to the scientists, we pray, that a vaccine may be found. Dear Father, for those countries where self-isolation is virtually impossible, we ask for mercy and deliverance. Gracious Father, may your name be known and praised throughout the world, and your light shine in the darkness. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we say the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, thank you, Wendy, for leading us in our prayers. And if you want to think more about the Trinity, if you want to dig a little bit deeper, there's a great video on the website, and the children's one is quite good as well. Best place to start is there. And we had a great quiz on Thursday night. Huge thanks to Clive and Margaret for hosting that for us. And huge congratulations to Anne Luckhurst, who was our quiz champion. Do join us after this service at 11:30 on Zoom for our virtual coffee and chat. It'd be lovely to see you. And so as we go out now into our world, as Jesus sent us, as he commanded us to go out, our hearts full of love, seeking justice for all, especially the excluded, we go now with this prayer of blessing. May God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all whom you love this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.